When I was a beginning artist, I wish I knew how color grading and compositing could vastly improve my renders. So here, I'll give an overview on my compositing and color grading workflow. I'll be using Blender 4 beta release, but these principles should hold up for previous and later versions. I'm using an older artwork of mine as an example. Feel free to follow with the template file linked in the description, or your own project. But first, let's make sure we mitigate any shadows or highlights being clipped. You could check this with the false color color space. This maps the colors in your scene to a rainbow thermal-like set of hues. If anything is pure white or black, then that means it's being clipped. For this, we'll want to use the depth pass in the render layer properties. This will be used for the fog. Now let's render and go over to the compositing workspace. The compositor behaves similarly to the shader node area. You can add nodes from the menu bar or with the keyboard shortcut Shift plus A. When you enable the node graph, there's a composite node on the output end and a render layer node on the other end. For the layout, I like to keep my image and compositing areas separate for a few reasons. Firstly, so I'm not trying to see past my node setup. Secondly, there's some important panels here that I want to see for color grading that we'll get to later. And lastly, it's closer to other compositing softwares like Nuke and Fusion, which I'm personally used to. In the node editor area on the right panel, there's a few important performance settings you can also check. OpenCL should be supported for most new computers. All right, let's jump to the effects. First, we'll add a little bit of fog. And I know this is an indoor scene, but even with an interior, adding a very subtle amount of fog or atmospheric contrast, if you will, can add a better sense of depth. First, I'll add a mix node with my render and fog color, then I'll plug in the depth or mist pass into the factor of that mix node. For better adjustment of the effect, I add a map range node between my depth pass to the factor. The map range node allows you to adjust the range of your depth pass to a range more meaningful for your mix factor. Since the farther points are in shadow in this case, I have to be more careful with keeping this minimal, otherwise it looks like the shadows are just a flat color. Next, we'll add glare with the glare node. There's multiple effects types you can do with this node. I start with the fog glow. The mix factor goes from negative 1 to 1. Negative 1 is only the input image, 1 is only the glare itself, and 0 is where the effect is merged onto the image. It's a little weird, but just so you know how that works. I turn it to 1 to isolate the glare that I'm getting and adjust the amount of glare with the threshold field. And feel free to add the other glare effect types as separate nodes if applicable to your render. Next, let's simulate noise from a camera sensor or grain in the case of film. An easy way to do digital noise without any textures, actually use a lens distortion node with just a white image input and jitter turned on. Then you can subtract the white and all you're left with is just the noise. Then you can just blend that into the original image. Shadows tend to be more affected by noise than the highlights. So I usually add a separate color node. You can also use a RGB to black and white node, and then further adjust that with a map range node. And in this case, since we want the shadows to be more affected, you'll want to invert the out range. So it starts from 1 and ends at 0. But you don't want the grain to be all the way. You don't want the grain to be super strong, unless it's supposed to be really old or really bad footage. So usually it's best to be very careful and very sensitive with this. Next we have a lens distortion. Thankfully this is just one node, just the lens distortion node. One field affects the shape of this distortion and the other affects the color aberration. The fit toggle just zooms in based on the amount of distortion you're applying. Most camera lenses nowadays are pretty minimal, or at least try to mitigate this effect. Some lenses are intentional in adding distortion or old-timey. If you want to go for that look, then you could be more generous with this distortion, but usually you'll need a very, very small amount of it. All right, now on to the color grading process. I mainly use a color balance node. If you open up the right panel in your image editor, you'll see a histogram, waveform, and vector scope diagrams. The histogram graphically represents the tonal distribution or brightness of your image. The waveform monitor is used to evaluate the brightness of your image. where any values at or near zero represent complete black with no detail, while anything at 100 or above is clipped at white with no detail. The objective is to try to keep your colors within this range. For this image, the contrast is such that the light overhead and the shadows underneath the bathroom stalls are going to clip a little bit no matter what. But I am trying to also mitigate that while also respecting the contrast of the image. Firstly, I use the offset and basis fields to shift the shadows to be closer to black. Secondly, I'll use the slope to shift the size of the color range so the highlights reach near white. Then I use the power field in the middle to determine the contrast. This first color balance node is mainly to adjust the overall color range. Then I can add another color balance node or other adjustment nodes like exposure or hue saturation value afterward to further adjust the color palette and style. And before I forget, we'll add a vignette. There's a couple ways to do this. I like to add a color balance node with the slope set to zero, and then I take a ellipse mask node and plug it into the factor. From there, then I'll adjust the size of the ellipse, and then you can smooth it out with a blur node, and then invert and further adjust the settings using another map range node. And again, you'll need to invert the out range in order for only the edges to be affected. But for a lot of this time, it's just tweaking. I go back and forth, tweaking how much distortion, how much fog, how much grain. It really is a matter of tinkering, but a good rule of thumb that I try to follow is most effects only need to be there just enough to notice. Doing too much usually can distract from the artwork, whereas too little is just extra processing time that's not really affecting the render. I do have a written version of this tutorial on Blender Artists. Link will be in the description. It also goes over render passes, and it also has a template file, not of this render, but of a variation of the default cube scene, just so you can see all the nodes in action. But thank you for watching, and I wish you a happy holidays and happy blending. Thank you.